everybody. Welcome on behalf of the MIT Poker Club and the McVicker Faculty Fellows Program that's bringing this to you. I can assure you, because you can see them up here live, that it's not just the trailer, it's going to be, or the movie, it's a real live performance by Richard Turner. And I don't think that I need to tell you why you're here. I think everybody understands why. And rather than introducing Richard myself, I would like to have his son, Asa, introduce his dad. Now, the thing I can say about Asa is the guy's a real card. He really is. No, and I mean that seriously. So his middle name is Spades. So his name is Asa Spades Turner. And I did ask Richard if that's what it really says on his birth certificate, and that is really what it says on his birth certificate. Now, also, it took a little bit of effort to get Richard to agree to let Asa actually attend this performance, because what actually Asa and Richard both told me is that when Asa was very young, he would go to Richard's performances, and of course he would hear the jokes and he would see the performance, and got to the point where, as Richard would tell a joke, just before he said the punchline, Asa would shout out from the audience the punchline. And so actually, I think you told me that you were banned from but anyway, I'm delighted that Asa Spades Turner is here to introduce his dad.
Good evening. So I am Asa Spades Turner, and I'd like to thank you all for coming. So what you are about to see may seem like magic. I can assure you it is not. It is all skill and very, very hard to do. He'll tell you about all how hard it is throughout the show. So throughout, you're also going to want to try to figure out how he's doing it. It's going to seem like he's bending probability to his will. So don't think about it now, but afterwards when we have questions, think about it then. So just sit back, relax, and enjoy the show.
And now I'll just bring up
my ladies, Annie, Poker Annie.
There we
go. Poker Annie, we have a chair for you. The president of the Poker Club. Give her a hand. And Trish, seat for you here. Well, howdy.
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 I knew there were a few laggers out there. Well, I'm Richard Turner. I represent why you should never play cards with strangers. I'm not a magician, but what I do can appear very magical. I'm what's known as a card mechanic, slang term, card shark. I demonstrate how many ways you can be taken at the card table. Now, before I go further, I was told originally that I need to keep it around 60 minutes. If I add a few things into there, will anybody get upset? In other words, give you more cheating to watch? All right. Because I wanted to put that up front because I kind of narrow things down. And anyway. Well, when you play poker, blackjack, bridge, hold'em, whatever your game, you want to make sure the cards are evenly mixed. And Poker Annie and I are going to show you how it's done, okay? Here's a deck for you and a deck for me. So just do as I do. Just follow the best you can. Just give the deck a few up-the-river cuts. Give it alternating up the river cut. Give it a flying three-way. Perfect. Now, casino procedures was called riffle, riffle, strip, riffle, cut. So first of all, you break them, you give them a riffle, you give them another riffle, and you give them what's called a strip cut or a box cut. It's a running cut, just reverses the top and bottom. Another riffle and a cut. That is basic casino procedure. Oh, you have a little trouble there? Oh, it's your right hand. It's screwing you up. I can fix that for you. Put them in your left hand, take them, break them to where they're even like this, lace them up, and give them a one-handed bridge. Now, I have shown you a half a dozen ways of shuffling and cutting the deck. They should be pretty evenly mixed, yes? Poker Annie, would you hold your cards off the table in your hands? Let's see if this deck is pretty evenly mixed. Do we have ace through king, ace through king, ace through king, king through ace? I shuffle the back into deck back into perfect numerical order. I don't like that random stuff. Would you do me a favor, Trish? Give that deck a shuffle and cut and just set them right there when you're done. The ladies are going to doing all the shuffling and cutting, and if there's box cards in there, just let us know and fix it. Pass the deck. Thank you, ma'am. Now, how many are familiar with the MIT students that are in the counters? Yes. Most of you, everybody has to know about them. Are they all face down? I didn't mean to flip a card over.
Nope.
Okay. Now, I can do this one of two ways. I can either just deal one person in pat hand, or I can, I was on a television show where one of these world-renowned card counters, he was going to demonstrate how he could beat the house. What they didn't know is they brought me in as the dealer for that segment. We filmed for 2 hours, and he never won a single hand. Pissed. We'll burn a card, and you will choose the situation each time. Poker Annie, how many players should we open the table with? Oh, three players, four players, pick a number.
Four.
Four players. One, two, three, four, und a Haus. One, two, you didn't know I spoke French, did you? Three, four. And what's that card, Poker Annie?
That's Ace of Diamonds.
That's an ace? What's your total here? Add them up.
16.
You got hit or stay?
Hit.
What's that card?
10.
Too many. Nine. What do you have here? Play it quickly.
Seven.
You're going to hit. What's that?
12.
What are you going to do?
Oh, sorry, it's a 5, so it's 12.
Altogether. It's still 12. Yeah. 7 and 5 is 12, no matter which way you add it together. And I didn't have to go to MIT to know that. What do you have?
I'll hit.
You want to play 22? That's played next door. What's that?
Ace.
Oh, that's take it low. That's a 13. You want another one? Or you stay?
I'll stay.
Man, you sure burned a lot of aces for us. Dang. What do you have here?
15.
Hit or stay?
Hit.
What's that?
2.
That's 18. 16, 18, right? You say you had 16? Yeah, you have 18. What's that?
13.
Hit. What's that?
20.
That's good. Okay. What is that? Is that two aces? What's that?
9.
21. Sorry. The hard way, mind you. I'm not going to go through the whole deck for the time's sake. Make sure they're all face down, shuffle them. Oh, here's your box card. And then set them up there out of my way. You shuffle this deck, yes?
Yes.
This time, I'm going to attempt to do what's called cull a slug. Now, the poker players out there, you should probably know what this means or maybe have heard of it. I'm going to do what she's doing there. That's good, Annie. Just set them right there. And I'm going to try to cull a slug. I can to my partner. I'm going to use casino procedure. I'll do this very slowly for you. Riffle. And let me just back up. You know how in a private game, the deck is passed around. It's Annie's deal. It's your deal. It's Trisha's deal. It's my deal. She just handed me a random deck. So I did riffle. Riffle. And you're supposed to do us a strip, which is reversing the tops and bottom halves of the deck. I'll do a bunch of riffle strips for you. Another riffle and a cut. That's basic casino procedure, as I said. And do you know what a cut or burnt card is, as in for blackjack or hold'em? You do. Yes. Everyone else there does. You know what they'll put a card face up on the bottom, or they'll burn a card, turn a card face up, or have a cut card. We're gonna deal a hand to hold'em. After the fact, you're gonna tell me how many people step up to my hold'em table. Hold'em is a game with large numbers, 6, 7, 8 players. How many players do we have, Trisha?
Six.
One, two, three, four. Four, five, six. One, two, three, four, five, six. Burn. And we have what's called the flop. And what is that card, Annie?
Ace of hearts.
Burn, turn. What's that card, Annie?
Ace of hearts.
Burn, turn. What's that card, Annie?
Ace of spades.
And let's get rid of our burnt card off the bottom. And these are all losers. Trust me, you're my secret partner. Sitting over here in hand number 5. What do you have in the pocket? What's that?
Oh, ace of diamonds.
You killed him, Annie. You killed him. 4 aces. and give that deck a quick shuffle, set them right there. Well, most of you know because they showed you a video and probably told you up front that I see with my mind and my fingers, yes? Yeah. Well, let me give you a little background. My vision started going south when I was 9. During my teens and 20s, my vision was measured at what's called 20 over 400, which is twice as low as what's considered legally blind. Then it all disappeared. And I have to admit, growing up with vision no better than the cartoon character Mr. Magoo can be very entertaining at times. Like watching as I stop trees, corridors, solid brick buildings with my bare head. Block with my head, protect my hands, valuable, not so valuable. My beautiful wife, and she's so immune to me running into things, I dashed to answer the phone, I ran square into the corner of a wall, split my head wide open, I'm gushing blood. She looked up from her book and said, "Now that one had to hurt." When you get off the phone, don't forget to wipe up the blood. I was on the driving range with my dentist. He went to talk to somebody. I didn't realize each time I put a ball down, I made a slight adjustment to the left. Instead of driving the balls at 12 o'clock, I was driving them at 9 o'clock, right towards the pro shop. And the golf pro is out there on a speaker going, "Hey, you in the blue shirt." And of course, I couldn't tell I was wearing a blue shirt. He said, "What the hell are you driving those balls over here for? Are you crazy, man?" I wondered who that jerk was in the blue shirt as I, bam, drove another 2-inch bullet right towards his face. When my son, Ace of Spades, was about 7 years old, we were at a restaurant, and he had to use the restroom. So we both sided up to a pair of urinals. And I'm being my normal goofy self, and I'm looking over and down at him going, "Oh, I'd love to pee and get the pee out of me." When all of a sudden I feel this little tap on my back, a voice from behind go, "Dad, I finished. That's another man you're singing to." And then when we got home and told my wife, she had to bring up the fact that he was little. I was looking over and down right at the guys. Yeah, embarrassed. I got up one morning to brush my teeth. I squirted toothpaste on my brush and started brushing. It tasted really bad. I went to my wife, I said, "What kind of toothpaste is this? It tastes awful." She laughed, she said, "That's not toothpaste, that's spermicide. It's for birth control. You keep using that, we'll never have kids." The most memorable moment came when I was 19. I came up with a great MIT idea for the blind and deaf driver. I bought a motorcycle. I would drive, my deaf friend Roy would tell me where to go. Right, left, red light, green light. It worked really well until one day we were pulled over for suspected armed robbery. We fit the profile to a T except for two minor details. The getaway driver wasn't blind, his accomplice wasn't deaf. Once we proved to the cop that we couldn't see the lights flashing or hear the siren blasting, I received a ticket for driving while blind, and he let us drive on. True story. Now you know what a goofball you're listening to. This is what I've learned about life. You know, we're all dealt different hands in life, and with those hands we make choices. A choice of mediocrity or painting a portrait of success. Over the next few minutes, you're going to become familiar with the acronym DEALT. D-E-A-L-T is in Delta Hand of Cards. D stands for dreams. Our dreams fuel the fire in our belly. E stands for excellence. What opens doors is becoming an expert, achieving a state of excellence. A stands for analysis. Socrates famously said, "An unexamined life is not worth living." L stands for loyalty. We must be loyal to our company, colleagues, customers, virtues such as honesty, integrity. And T stands for tenacity. Tenacity breaks down the barriers that stand between us and our dream. Now, my dream was to be a card shark. Many times I've been asked, "Growing up, did you actually want to be a card shark? Weren't you normal like the rest of us and want to be something respectable like a doctor, lawyer, hamburger flipper, or perhaps most feared of all, a MIT professor, statistics professor?" I didn't want to be any of those things. Growing up, my dream was to kick like Chuck Norris. I wanted strength like Charlton Heston demonstrated in the old movie Ben-Hur. But my most daunting aspiration was to be a card shark like James Garner's character from the TV series Maverick. And it does strike me as odd, the impact that TV and movies had on my life. Chuck Norris, Charlton Heston, James Garner. As my wife says, it's a good thing I never saw the Texas Chainsaw Massacre. We'll start with the letter D, dreams. Henry David Thoreau once said, if one advances confidently in the direction of his dream, he will meet with success unexpectedly in common hours. Here are a few questions to consider towards reaching your dream and painting your own personal portrait of success. You know, what makes a world champion? What separates good from great? Why do some people become world-class while others, despite their best effort, never rise above mediocrity? You know, people that rise to the level of mediocrity often end up there because they have no dream. In their mind's eye, they have no portrait of success. They have not developed the framework within which to fully examine their potential. There's no fire in their belly, no dream. And if you notice this, they'll let the littlest things shut them down, like doubt. You know, we don't become world-class if we're full of self-doubt. Rather, if we have a portrait of success firmly embedded in our brain, whatever we set our mind to, despite the naysayers, and when you go through life and you're there everywhere, we still achieve our dreams. And of course, tonight I know I'm speaking to the choir because you are MIT students. And I have only three things to say to you. Congratulations for what you've done, for what you're doing, and what you're going to do. Now, as I said, I'm kind of an oddball, an odd duck. I wanted to be a card mechanic. And let me explain something. The general public don't realize there's a distinction. There's a big difference between a card mechanic and a card magician. A card mechanic is someone who can control the outcome of a card game. And the techniques for the card table are literally 1,000 times more difficult to develop than the techniques used to perform card magic. And I've been very fortunate that I've had the privilege of working with some of the most respected people in the areas I was interested. In 1975, I had the privilege of starting to train with a man named Professor Di Vernon. He was born in 1894. He lived to be over 98 years old. And for over half a century, he was considered the best in the world with a deck of cards. He was also known as the man who fooled Houdini. And that took place back in 1919, almost a century ago. And I had the privilege of working with Professor Vernon for 17 years. And during those years, Professor would describe to me very intricate card concepts and card moves. And the thing is, he didn't describe them to me in the way that he could do them or the way that others could do them. But because I couldn't see what he was showing me, he tricked me. He described them to me in the way he wished they could be done. And only after I spent thousands of hours and mastered the moves and concepts did he finally admit to me he made them up. He thought they were impossible. He just wanted to see what I'd come up with. I'm going to show you a few things that Professor said was not possible. Poker Annie, you shuffle the cards, yes?
Yep.
We're going to deal my favorite game, which is the predecessor to Hold'em, seven card stud. Who here has played seven stud? Say yes.
Yes.
Oh, boy, a bunch of players out there. What's your name over here who said yes, gentlemen?
Jason.
How many players should we have, Jason? Four, five, six, pick a number. You're my partner. You want to set it one, two, three, four, or five?
Four.
Five and four. One, two, three, Jason, and five. Now watch this. Annie, I want you to take the rest of the deck and mix it up, and then pull out a stack of cards and hand them to me. Don't give me the whole deck. We're going to make this as impossible as possible. She's going to do everything she can to screw things up. Just put a mix and put a stack of cards in my hand. Oh, she is stingy, too. Okay, we have player one, two, three, and we have player Jason, player five. Take those backs, mix them all together, hand me any part of that deck you like, and I'll keep my messes in order here while you do that. Hand me a random stack of cards. Thank you. You added five cards more than last time. One, two, three, and Jason chose number four. What's that card, Annie? Oh, that's a decent card. Take them, mix them up, hand me any part of the deck you like. Shuffle them together and just hand me a random stack of cards. Oh, she got stingy again. And we have player five. Player one, player two, player three, player Jason. What's that card, Annie?
Ace of hearts.
Well, that's a good card. They go together, mix them up. Hand me any part of the deck. Two more cards than last time. Player five, player one, player two, player three. What's that card?
Queen of clubs.
Ooh, that's looking good, Jason, looking good. Look what Annie's doing for you. They don't call her Poker Annie for nothing. Do you know her sister? Her sister's name is Poker Alice. Oh my gosh, I'm not gonna make it around the table with that few of cards. She was really trying to see how far she could take it. Player five, player one, player two, player three, player Jason, what's that?
Ten of clubs.
Pair of tens, but this will be the last card, mix them up. And Poker Alice used to smoke long glass cigars, she drank her whiskey straight. She's one of the top cheaters in the country during the 19th century, but she always read her Bible on Sunday. Thank you, Miss Annie. And player five. Now we have what's called down and dirty. Y'all wonder where that expression came from? It came from this game. Put that with the rest of the stack, Annie. Thank you. So let's reiterate. Once again, Annie shuffled, cut. Jason chose five players, fourth position, seven card stud. And we're playing high Chicago. That means high spade in the hole, splits the pot. He chose hand number four. She shuffled every time. Let's see what Jason has. Again, Annie, what's that?
Ten.
Yeah. What's that?
Queen.
What's that?
Ace.
What's that?
Ten.
Pair of tens. What's that?
Ace.
Ace of what?
Clubs.
Ace of clubs. What's that?
Jack of hearts.
Well, you're sitting on a belly buster. Inside straight. You got a king, you got an ace side straight, but we're playing high spade in the hole. What's that?
Ace of spades.
Full house. Aces over tens, high spade in the hole. You killed them, Jason. But thank you. So you guys, you're the smart ones. Your job is to think about how he could take a deck and have them constantly randomized every time and then still control the outcome under those conditions. Kind of makes you think twice, doesn't it? Hand me the rest of the cards.
Some are face up.
You're going to fix them in just a second.
Right.
Now you're going to fix them. She didn't think she was going to get that free seat for, that good seat for nothing. All one direction. Yep. I'm going to show you a few things that I was not planning on showing you, but since you said I can take a few more minutes, I'm going to show you. Clean up my mess here. Name a card, Annie.
Two of clubs.
Take out all the deuces. Set them right here. All the twos, all five of them.
There's five?
There's five? Is he cheating? Well, we'll work with whatever you find.
Okay.
I keep the fifth one up my sleeve.
Oh.
You want to see it?
Sure.
She peeked. You got four twos?
Yep, four twos.
Oh, you are so quick. Hand them to me, face up. Thank you. And we'll clean up this mess-a-roni here. What is your favorite suit? Spade, diamond, club, or heart?
Spade.
Pull the spade. Take the spade. I'm going to leave the other three deuces on the bottom. Everybody with me? Did that overhead camera ever come back on?
Yes.
No, okay. Oh, it did? Hand me the two of spades face up. Watch the two of spades. You're going to understand what I do. I want the two of spades. So what happens is I will deal cards around the table to the other players. Only when I'm ready do I deal the deuce of spades. Watch face up. Watch face up. See how the card sits there as the second card is dealt, but you have to deal it as neatly as if you're dealing off the top, see? And they're not off the bottom. The other twos haven't moved, and the first card that was dealt, whichever one it was, is not a two. Watch again. I'll deal it in super slow motion, super slow motion.
Do you want this card too?
Oh, yeah. Thank you, Annie. You're doing your job so well. Watch the deuce on top, super slow motion. See, I will hit the other players. Watch face up. And this is fully exposed, mind you. They never give you this type of an angle or this slow, see? The card sits there till I want the card. It's one-handed. When the deuce is face down, when it's face down, see, you can't tell you've been swindled. Isn't that fun?
Yeah.
That's called dealing seconds. Thank you. Is that four twos? Is that four twos?
Yep, four twos.
Okay, here's the interesting one. This is something I was not gonna show you, but I'm gonna show you now. Four deuces. Let's say the gambler kept them on the top or bottom during the shuffle. When a deck is cut, anything on the top or bottom end up where? Tell him, Poker Alice, Poker Annie.
Middle.
She is so good. That's right, in the center. Four twos in the center. Everybody take a peek. So for a century, what was considered the ultimate was to deal from the middle, because back in the old days, you had to let someone cut the deck. Nowadays, they don't do that anymore. It separates the amateur cheater from the professional. We'll deal a hand of hold'em. Jason?
Yep.
Give me a number of players, 4, 5, or 6?
6.
Excuse me, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. And then hold'em, as we know, we have the pocket cards, we have a burn, and we have the flop. Miss Annie, what's that card?
2 of diamonds.
A burn and a turn. Miss Annie, what's that card?
2 of clubs.
A burn and a turn. Miss Annie, what's that card?
2 of hearts.
And did you see the first one come out in the dealer's hand? What's that?
2 of spades.
4 twos to the dealer. But the point is, they were dealt from the middle, not the bottom or the second, but from the center. You follow what I'm saying? Yeah. Well, D stands for dreams, E stands for excellence. You know, what opens doors is becoming an expert achieving a state of excellence. My first director was a man named Steve Terrell. He was a TV and movie star back in the early, throughout the 50s and early 60s. And he formed a theater company called the Lamb's Players, and I was with him from 1972 to 78. And during those years, he taught me how to play the part of a sighted person, how to look people in the eye and give them the impression that I could see them. He also said, you love cards. He'd sit there behind scenes. I would constantly practice. He says, you love cards. He said, if you become the best card man in the world, you will earn the respect of others, and that will open doors for you. Professor Vernon said something very similar. He said, if you can do anything, he says, it doesn't matter what it is, if you can do anything better than everyone else in the world, people will try to break down your doors to meet you. You don't have to worry about looking for money. If you're world class, you don't have to chase after money. Money will find you. It's a byproduct of success and becoming the best. Did Steve Jobs chase after money, or did he chase after perfection in his products? If anyone knows anything about Jobs, he was obsessive. He chased after perfection. And did money find Jobs in Apple? History. And how does it happen? Four-letter words, some people think are cuss words. 2 words are hard work. You know, it takes 10 years of hard work to become an overnight success. Yeah. Many Olympic athletes would argue that spending hours a day in the gym or running dozens of wind sprints on the track is not exactly fun. Still, they love it. But world-class performance requires world-class discipline. And as I like to say, discipline breeds discipline. Discipline breeds discipline. The more you do something, the better you can do it. Now, there's another expression I don't agree with, and that is practice makes perfect. Y'all heard that? No, practice not make perfect. You can practice something wrong, and when you're done, it's perfectly wrong. Perfect, perfect practice makes perfect. Malcolm Gladwell talks about the rule of 10,000 hours. Some of you heard of Malcolm Gladwell. He said to become a true, do I have all the cards? To become a true expert, a real master, you must devote at least 10,000 hours to your craft. That breaks down to 3 hours a day, 7 days a week for 10 years straight. I started messing around with cards, I hate to even say this, 55 years ago now. And I've made a living with cards for over 40 years. But there was a period of time when I practiced, and I'm serious, 10 to 20 hours a day, 7 days a week, for 26 years straight. And then I started slacking a bit and I dropped to 3 to 10 hours a day. I'm gonna show you what obsessive compulsive behavior can do for you too. Pick a number 10 to 20, Annie.
18.
Watch, I'm gonna try to cut with one hand 18 cards. Can you count them out loud on the table so everybody can hear like this, one on top of the other?
Two,
a little faster.
8, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16, 17, 18.
We did it, Annie, we did it. I'll do it again, I'll make it more difficult. Any number 1 to 52, but you don't want to say 52 because I passed the deck, nobody cares. 10 to 40 square stuff. Somebody out there call a number.
33.
33?
Yep.
33?
Yes.
Out loud, one on top of the other.
1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12,
13, 14, 15, 16, 17, 18, 19, 20, 21, 22, 23, 24, 25, 26, 27, 28, 29, 30, 31, 32, 33. We did it again, Annie. You know that? We should go on the road together. Let's try this. 3 and 10. 3 and 9. 1, 2, 3. 3 times the amount. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. Isn't that fun? And then until you go home and try that, you don't realize how tough that is. Andy, would you do me a favor? Take half the deck, cut it here, and then put the other half on top when you're done. Cut and finish. Got it?
Yep.
All right. So I'll show you one of the purposes for being able to feel exact number of cards by thickness, and that's the reverse of dealing from the middle. When you're dealing from the middle, half the battle is knowing where that card is in the middle, right? The other half is getting out without getting shot. Give me a number of players, Annie. 3, 4, 5. Pick a number.
Four.
4 players. You're my secret partner. You want to set it 1, 2, 3, or 4?
2.
Number 2. And once again, the only way you're allowed to shuffle in the casinos, you keep the deck face down on the table, and Annie just did whatever she did to the cards. You want 4 players, second position. And what were the cards that you selected earlier? Twos, was it twos?
Twos, yeah.
Twos, yeah. Okay, take the deck. I'm gonna let you do her deal, so I'm not doing anything crooked. Deal a card off the top right here, face up, player one.
Face up.
Okay, just so we can see. Face up number 2, what's that card?
2 of diamonds.
You chose position number 2, okay, player 3. Player 4. Player 1. Face up number 2. What's that?
2 of hearts.
Keep dealing. Remember, we're partners. Keep dealing. Keep dealing. Keep dealing. What's that? Start betting, Annie. Jason has money. Keep going. What's the next card? 4 deuces. All right. Shuffle them up. Shuffle them up. But did you follow? I shuffled her cards back in the deck exactly where she chose, and she dealt them to prove that it happened. Okay. Handy technique, handy thing to be able to do. D stands for dreams, E stands for excellent, A stands for analysis. You know, we must analyze our obstacles, we must analyze our assets. And of course, my first big obstacle to deal with was the loss of sight. I was 9 years old when a disease began ravaging the retina in my eyes and I began to go blind. One day I could see the chalkboard, next day I couldn't. And to my dismay, I was shipped off to a special school where they had what was called a VH room. VH stood for visually handicapped. I hated the word handicapped and I despised the word blind. And the sighted students were not very nice to us in the VH department. One kid would flip the bird in front of my face and he'd go, "Hey, Magoo, how many fingers am I holding up?" And while I was distracted, his friend would sneak up behind me and pick the wallet out of my pocket. He would then dangle it in front of my face going, "Hey, Magoo, got any money?" And when I'd grab for my wallet, he'd throw it over my head to his friend behind me in a cruel game of keep away. And the tees turned ugly when they started slapping me across the cheeks going, "Can you see to grab your money, blind boy?" The other kid jumped on my back, drove me to the ground, kicked me in the ribs, and they ran off laughing with my money, saying, "Thanks for the money, Magoo." As I laid there weeping, I vowed, "One day I'm going to learn karate and kick in your faces." I did. When I first started losing my sight, I was really mad. But the loss of vision turned out to be a blessing and one of my greatest assets. Let's talk about assets. You know, if we defeat adversity with honor and integrity, we can turn adversity into an asset, and that can lead to prosperity. Adversity leads to prosperity. I heard as a little blind boy, Stevie Wonder could hear a mouse walk. That is so cool. He turned that fine sense of hearing into a tremendous musical asset. Now, how do we do that? Tools. You know, we must use all of our tools. We also so depend on what we see for our input that we tend to minimize the power of our other senses. Hear, smell, taste, touch, our other 4 tools. Now, after people see what I can do with the cards, they often ask, "How is it possible to do that?" And you're probably asking that same question. And I understand the subtext of your question is, how can someone take a shuffled deck and deal a winning hand anytime he wants and the guy can't see anything? Now, if we've lost something crucial, does it mean it's over? As we should say as a kid, no way, Jose. You know, a central theme of modern neuroscience is what is known as brain plasticity. We've all heard how when a person loses one or more of their primary senses, the surviving senses compensate by becoming much sharper. And neuroscience have found this is partly rooted in a phenomenon known as neuroplasticity. And that is where neurons, we're talking about dead neurons, regenerate and reorganize themselves around one or more of their surviving senses. Now, when my vision started going south, I was blessed in two ways. One was with an enhanced sense of touch, and the other was the ability to see without sight. Now, that sounds weird, see without sight. I have a very rare visual condition, first documented in 1760 called Chaubonnet syndrome, CBS, or what Dr. Oliver Sacks calls seeing with the mind's eye. And a lot of these topics will be thoroughly covered in that documentary that you saw, and they've been filming for 4 years, and it premieres next month at South by Southwest Film Festival, and then it'll eventually be everywhere. So watch for it, called DELT. Charles Bonnet syndrome is a condition where a person who has lost their sight should see nothing, black, right? Still sees colors, patterns, shapes, and there's no medical explanation for this phenomenon. And I'm actually one of the most extreme cases of CBS on the planet, and the only one known that can actually manipulate the colors and patterns, images, into creating functional vision. Let me try to kind of describe how I see things. I see a 360-degree kaleidoscope of beautiful reds, blues, yellows, green, every subconscious image you can imagine. And the thing is, I don't see these images in the back of the brain, like when you're dreaming or imagining things. I look at them. I see them in front of me. I see them in external space. I see them in front of me just as clearly as you see everything that's in front of you. And these reds, blues, yellows, greens are just as vivid if my eyes are open, closed, if it's day or pitch black night. Now, here's the cool thing. I can organize these images into creating vision. Let's say I want to remember questions for a final or memorize a theater script or just remember a phone number. I can write the phone number down in the air, and I will see it floating in the air just as clearly as you would see it on a computer screen, chalkboard. The mind's eye, I take a picture of it, and because I have what's called an eidetic memory, I'll never forget it. Did you know that the density of nerve endings in the fingertips is higher than on the fingertips than any other part of the flesh? I have a gentleman, we know there's one exception to this case. And thanks to my slow people out there. And thanks to my touch, I've had the privilege of entertaining the rich, famous, and infamous from all over the world. I've entertained legends like Johnny Carson, Gene Kelly, Gregory Peck, Jimmy Stewart, Bob Hope, and other people like Bob Odenkirk from Breaking Bad, Better Call Saul, Brad Pitt, cheated him in an Oscar-nominated film. And I bet you half of you don't even know half those names, right? Legends, but way past your time, before your time, rather. I could also say that I've been kidnapped and hugged by the three-time boxing champion of the world, Muhammad Ali. If you ever heard of Muhammad Ali, say yes.
Yes.
Oh, good. Wonderful man. I was in a casino when four big African-American men snatched me. They shoved me out the back of the casino, stuffed me in a limo zipped away, pulled it behind another casino. They shoved me through a door into a big suite where Ali came running up, threw his arms around me in a big bear hug and goes, Richard, how you doing? It's so good to see you again. May I have the cards? Ali heard how I could find randomly selected cards in under seemingly impossible circumstances. You want me to show you how I'm finding cards? People find it kind of fascinating. Miss Trisha, would you touch a card? Take it out. Got it?
Got it.
And point to somebody out here, Trisha. Okay. Say their name.
Nora.
Nora, say stop. Pull out the card for Nora. Just show it to her and set it right there for Nora. And Poker Annie, would you point to somebody? What's her name?
Lucy.
Lucy, say stop.
Stop.
Is that card okay?
Oh.
Yeah. Okay, show Lucy your card. Put it face down right here. And Poker Annie, pull a card for yourself. So we have a number of cards selected in whatever ways you selected them. Trisha, would you say stop?
Stop.
Drop your card face down on the deck. Okay? Now, your job is to follow your card. Here we go. Follow your card. Follow. Follow your card. Follow your card. Follow your card. Follow. Now, watch this shuffle. Let's see if the camera can catch it from a front. Watch. Let's see if I do this slow motion. See how the cards go every other card? Slow motion. Isn't that fun? Sort of like a machine or something. All right, Nora. Show Nora, everybody, Nora's card again. Nora, say stop.
Stop.
Drop the card for us. Okay, Ms. Nora, follow your card. Follow the yellow brick card. And Lucy, can you put Lucy's card back for us? Show her card. Everybody see Lucy's card? Okay. Remember your card, Lucy. Follow your card. And some people think they're on the top or the bottom, but, you know, that's kind of cheesy, as Joel will tell you. And who else has it? You have a card too, right?
Yep.
Here, put your card on top. Where's your card right now?
On the top.
I can find it that fast. Would you do me a favor? Cut half the deck here, and then put the other half on top when you're finished. So is your card on top now?
No.
If it is, you are fast. All right. We'll give the deck once again a few riffles. And we will start with Miss Annie. Cut the deck for me, Annie, and put the other half on top. And did you cut your card? Is that your card, yes or no?
No.
That's not your card? You need my help. Would you like me to cut your card to the top of the deck, bottom of the deck, or right out of the middle? You call.
Right out of the middle.
Watch carefully. She wants me to cut a card right from the center. I do it in slow motion so you know there's nothing trickery going on. What was your card, Annie?
King of Spades.
What's that?
King of Spades.
That's very close. Would you cut the deck for Lucy? Cut the deck and put the other half on top. And Lucy, is that your card? Top, bottom, or middle, Lucy? What do you like? And do you remember what the suit of your card is?
Yeah.
What was your card?
What's
the only difference is the shape. Yeah, that's the cleaning club?
Yeah.
Okay, good. Cut the deck for Nora. Got it? Okay. Finish it?
Yeah.
All right. Nora, did she get lucky? Yes or no?
No.
Let's see. Let's do something different. Nora, what's your favorite number under 10? No, your favorite number under 10.
7.
Can you do me a favor? Take the deck, no. Count down 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, and turn over the 7th card.
1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7.
Is that her, is that her card? Shuffle them up. You got a good shuffler. Is all this making sense to everybody? Okay, good. All right. Did you have a card?
I did, yeah.
Oh, I almost forgot. I didn't forget. I just forgot that I forgot. Okay, would you do me a... Okay, let's see here. I know what I'm going to do here. Let me think about this twice. Okay, would you pull out a card for me, Annie? Grab one. Got it?
Yep.
All righty. Let everybody see your card, Annie. Annie, say stop.
Stop.
Okay, drop your card. Put it back. Okay. Bury it. Okay. Let's see here. I guess I may as well give it a shuffle or two, just for the heck of it. And who should I start with? I'll start with Miss Poker Annie. Annie, what is that card out loud?
Ace of Spades.
Ace of Spades is the correct answer. Would you do me a favor? Put your fingers straight up and down like this. Straight up and down like that. I think that's your card. What's that card?
Seven of Diamonds.
Seven of Diamonds. Tricia, is that the card you chose, the Seven of Diamonds?
No.
Would you, huh?
No.
Would you take? What'd she have?
Oh. Wait,
what was her card? You don't remember your card was? What was her card? Is this face up? Huh? Is this card face up? Yes or no?
Face up.
Is it face up?
No, it's face down.
It's face down.
Oh,
sorry. Oh, yeah, the difference is you can see it, and the other way you can't. Yeah. Sometimes you have to explain things to the elders. What was your card?
Now I can't remember.
Help her out? Ace of spades?
I think it was the ace of spades, yes.
Yeah, what was your card?
Ace of spades.
Oh, no, what was the card you took out of the deck? She had the ace of spades.
Oh, three of hearts.
Three of hearts. Okay, you guys got... Okay, what is this card here? Do you remember what this card was?
Ace of spades.
And what's that one?
Wait.
Is that yours? You did a good job of shuffling things up. For a second, I thought they screwed up. Are they all face down?
Yep.
Okay. Since we're having fun, we're gonna do another one. You do as I do, okay?
Okay.
Cut the deck like this a bunch of times. Follow the process, everybody. Now give it that shuffle. I think you were doing like this, kind of that old-fashioned shuffle.
Yep.
Go ahead and give it a shuffle like that. All right. I think you were doing this too earlier, weren't you?
Yep.
Oops. Yep. Okay. Yeah. Overhand shuffle. That's fine. Okay.
Face up on the top.
Oh, go ahead and fix it. Thank you, Maya. You're doing a good job. Okay, now I'll give it a casino shuffle. One. Okay. Very good. Now set them face down right here.
Okay.
And would you, have you reach across. Now cut my deck a few times. Cut it, finish it. Okay. Now take your deck and do this. Just reach in and pull out a card out of the middle. Got one?
Yep.
Show the audience. Look at it yourself. Got it?
Yeah.
Okay, you should remember, yes. Put it on top so everybody follows. Ready? Got it?
Yep.
Now cut the deck, put the other half on top. Got it?
Yep.
Okay, now do as I, here we go again. Give it the overhand shuffle like you had. Okay, now give it a casino shuffle. Couple of them, there we go. All right, now reach across and cut my deck and finish it. Finish it. Okay, now let me cut yours real quick. Set it on the table. Now, take your deck, go through it, pull out your card, and turn it face up on the table. Just thumb through the card, turn it face up. Look for you, find your card. The easiest way is to look at them. See, that's the old-fashioned way. Tell me when you have your card. Okay, put it face up on the table. What is it?
King of spades.
Okay, now I'm going to do it not the old-fashioned way. I'm going to just try cutting a card right out of the middle. Remember, we both shuffled each other's deck back and forth. What's that? All right, you can give them a shuffle. Each of you give a quick shuffle, set them aside. All right, D stands for dreams, E stands for excellent, A stands for analysis, L stands for loyalty. We must be loyal to our company, colleagues, and customers. And when you graduate, get a position. To reach the top, you must create within yourself and for your company a value greater than what you were hired to do. And you must be passionate about what you do. You know, there's no stronger emotional component for success than passion. I was obviously passionate about cars. Started in the 70s, I was hired to entertain. But as an added bonus, I got my client, my performing venues, what is known in the industry as earned media. I got them priceless free national and international publicity, worldwide television, newspaper features, magazine cover stories. And whenever I did a television show or interviewed for a paper, I always mentioned my show times and the name of my client, made sure they mentioned it, which is very, very expensive free advertising. You know, so you must analyze what personal passion, attribute, talent you have that you can develop to become a greater asset for your company or just to reach your own personal dreams. We also must be loyal to virtues such as honesty and integrity. Now, if we choose to cheat to reach the top, even five aces will be a loser. You shuffle this deck, yes?
Yes.
Would you grab the cards in the middle? What do you have?
Four aces.
Show everybody. Hand me this deck. There's an Old West tombstone that reads, played five aces, now plays a harp. What's that, Annie?
It's an ace of spades.
The fifth ace. Bang, you're dead. Shuffle. Because of my card skills, I could be a very rich dead man. Started in the early 80s, my notoriety with the cards began filtering down to the years of the underworld. And I've been wined and dined by some very powerful crime families. One mobster, after seeing what I could do with the cards, said, we'll give you a grand a day to come work for us. I said, no thanks. He said, $2,000 a day. I again politely refused. He said, how much will it cost to buy you? You know, I instantly had visions of waking up with a horse's head lying next to me. Godfather movie. Another offer came from the Middle East. It started off with a phone call, a very strongly accented voice. Wanted to talk to me about doing business. I said, meet me aboard the riverboat where I was a nightly entertainment. I get aboard the boat. It was a party of five men of Middle Eastern descent, and only one spoke English. The interpreter threw a stack of bills on my table and said, let's see what you can do with the cards. I showed him after. He said, we'll give you $10,000 a week to come to the Middle East and play cards for oil money. I said, no thanks. And he was irate with me. He said, what? You're turning down $10,000 a week? I said, yep. We argued with his boss in some foreign language. Then he turned back and he said, how about $20,000 a week? $30,000 a week? Finally, he said, how about $1,000,000? Now, he didn't say if that was by the week. But I did say no. Irritated, they threw another stack of bills on my table and left. And because there were so many, I thought they were all ones or fives. They were all $100 bills. Still had a good night and didn't have to put myself in a position where I'd be 100% used. This next mobster, he was very rich, very powerful, and over the course of a number of years made me a series of offers to cheat. We were dining in his beautiful mountaintop mansion. I told him about the offer I have from the Middle East, and he told me, don't take it. He said, in a situation like that, you'll be 100% used. He added, you understand what I'm trying to tell you? For those that don't know what 100% used means, it means they kill you when they're done with you. I told him I know what it means. He said, those Middle East oil men, he said, they own half the world. He said, we own the other half. Those were his very words. He said, we can arrange to have these card games take place in the United States, and we'll back you here. I thought to myself, wow, I'll be 100% used in my own country. That's the deal I was looking for. Now, I have to confess, over the years, I have had people openly challenge me to use my skills to try to beat them. Now, I love situations like that because I had permission to cheat. And most of these were very successful businessmen where the loss of 10 or 20 grand meant nothing. I had this one guy, he owned a large commercial construction company. He wanted to cut high card double or nothing. He cut a 10 and I cut, what's that card, Trish? I cut an ace. He said, let's double it again. He cut a king and I cut, what's that card?
Ace of hearts.
I cut another ace. He said, let's double it again. He cut a jack and I cut, what's that?
Ace of diamonds.
Again, he asked to double. He cut another king and I cut, what's that card?
Ace of hearts.
Is that four aces?
Yeah.
And that night, we doubled over a dozen times before he finally surrendered, exponentially multiplying my wins, mind you. Do you mind if I tell people who you really are? Do you guys know who she is?
No.
Jason, yes, no?
No.
She's known as Middle Deal Maud. She can deal cards from the center of the deck. You'll swear they're coming off the top. You don't mind showing off a little bit, do you? Give the deck a quick shuffle.
Okay.
All right, that's good. We dealt stud, we dealt hold'em, we dealt blackjack. This time we'll do a five-card draw. We'll make it real easy, only three players. Deal a card off the top, face down right here, player one. Face down for poker, Annie. And now don't take mine off the top or the bottom. Reach in the middle of the deck and deal a card right here for me, face down. Out of the middle. Watch this, folks. Ooh, did you see that technique? Card number two. You're going to have five cards to each player. Card number two, card number two, and mine out of the middle. Watch this. Out of the middle. Watch this techniques. Ooh, invisible. Card number three, card number three, card number three. Only mine out of the middle. Not the top or bottom. Out of the middle. not quite as fast. Card number four, card number four, card number four. Out of the middle, out of the middle. Invisible. Card number five, card number five, card number five.
We're in the middle.
Out of the middle, always out of the middle, yeah.
There we go.
Okay, good. Do you mind, take your hand, play your hand, and we're playing five-card draw, so you, it's just the same as hold them, just look for the best hand. We'll fold it. So look at your cards. The cards you like, keep, and the ones you don't like, middle deal, mods, feel fresh in your hand, okay?
Okay.
Okay. So you draw first.
I draw
from your hands in your hand, cards in your hand. You have five cards, right?
Yes.
Like if you have a pair, keep it. If you have two pair, keep it. If you have three of a kind, keep it. Four cards to a straight a flush, you might keep it. If you have a royal flush, throw it away.
So I just give you one card?
No, throw whatever you, just throw it away and then tell her, she'll give you some, how many
I'll
you
give
want?
You another card.
Another card.
She want, you want what, you're keeping
one.
Four?
One, yeah.
She's keeping four, ooh dear. Okay, and I want Uno also. From the middle, watch this
from
everybody.
The
from the middle, from the middle.
Okay.
Good, clean up your mess, clean up your mess, clean up your mess. Okay, once again, she shuffled, she cut, and she dealt. People always say, what happens when someone else is doing the dealing? What do you have in your hand?
Sevens.
How many?
Two.
Okay.
Pair of sevens.
Oh, I have a pair too. What's that?
Ace.
What's that?
It's another ace.
What's that? You need a card back? Face down. She's good, isn't she? Shuffle them all up. Shuffle them up. Get all the cards back to her? Oh, there's another one. There's a straggler. D stands for dreams, E stands for excellent, A stands for analysis, L stands for loyalties, T stands for tenacity. I like that word, tenacity. It's fun to say tenacity, tenacity. It's all tongue, tenacity. And what is tenacity? You know, tenacity breaks down the barriers that stand between us and our dream. As I stated earlier, one of my dreams was to kick like Chuck Norris. Chuck Norris was also teased and harassed as a kid, and like Master Norris, I started karate training. My karate instructor was Master John Murphy. Murphy had what was considered the toughest black belt test in the country. To earn a black belt under this crazy man Murphy, you had to fight a 10, 3-minute round bout with a fresh black belt each round. Boxer goes, same guy getting tired, fresh guy each round. And Murphy didn't want to deal with lawsuits, so all the testing and training took place across the border in Tijuana. Seriously. When 1 year at the Tijuana Forum, I was one of three people that brought back the great Chuck Norris in a showdown against a group that they called themselves the Black Federation. And I was by far the weakest fighter, and I hope that confrontation did not escalate. Fortunately for me, one stern look from the Master Chuck Norris and the Federation backed down and left. Now, when I first started karate, my initial concern was fear. The fear of getting smashed in the face from a kick I couldn't see coming. And in the early years, fear alone could trigger an asthma attack, and you can't fight if you can't breathe. You know, fear can paralyze. I mean, we can be so worried about doing the wrong thing that we do nothing. There's an old English proverb that warns us, a man that's afraid to make a mistake is unlikely to make anything. In other words, totally worthless. You know, fear of failure, when left unchecked, can lead to the very failure we fear. However, fear can motivate. I think it's important that we seek out specific constructive criticism. And when we get it, don't get defensive. That's our first inclination, get defensive. No, you get offensive. We must attack our weaknesses with vigor. When I could still see amorphous shapes, my karate instructor would tell me, never advertise your weakness. Don't let them know all you see is a big blurry blob. Stare them down like you could see them and bulldoze right through them. The master martial artist Bruce Lee said, there are no limits, there are plateaus, but you must not stay there. You must go beyond them. If it kills you, it kills you. I like that. If it kills you, it kills you. Well, I realized if I was ever going to survive 10 three-minute rounds, I had to overcome the paralyzing effects of fear. Like they say on That's Incredible, don't try this at home. I started climbing 1,000-foot cliffs. I learned to swing on the trapeze. I took 40-foot high falls. I would tightrope around the rim of multi-story buildings, and I hunted sharks. All true. Murphy also said you need to have a body of steel. I flash back to my childhood memories of Charlton Heston chained to the ship, pulling the oar with his big bulging biceps. I don't know if you ever saw that movie. Well, that image of strength always encouraged me to want to be stronger, so I trained harder. And Murphy pushed me to the point of being able to do 500 push-ups in 12 minutes, 9 seconds. I topped out at 340 on the bench press, and I could curl and military more than my own body weight, and I could also do the splits across two chairs and touch my head to the floor. Well, it took 13 years and 3 months of obsessive training before I was finally ready to take on the 10 men. And because of my card fame, the pressure was on me big time. The TV and print media were there, including ABC Television and the Los Angeles Times. Now, Murphy said, relax. All you have to do is come out alive with spirit. I said, exactly what does that mean, alive with spirit? He said, even if your teeth have been punched down your throat, you're still smiling. Well, during the test, I hit some of these guys so hard I knocked them silly, but they were fresh, and I was not. When it was all said and done, I had one bruise, started at my head and at my toe. I had a smashed bloody nose, ruptured right eardrum. I had my groin kicked into my throat many times. It was an open target. And I fought the last 3.5 rounds with a broken right arm right there. Caught a roundhouse with a kick and it snapped it. And the next day, the whole bloody mess was spread across the front page of the Los Angeles Times sports section. Now, I don't recommend that we use our faces to block punches. It hurts. But I do say that we can face our fears, and through a little tenacity, we can overcome them. Now, I also remember, there's no fear in being afraid. Trust me, having 10 guys want to put the hurt on me, I was afraid. Shame comes from hiding in the corner, wallowing in fear. Consider Beethoven. I like that guy. In Beethoven's later years, he was deaf. Yet during those years, he created some of the greatest music in the history of the world. He'd press his ear to the piano and hit the chords with such force, the sound would vibrate in his head. That's tenacity of purpose. Now, I'm going to show you how, through a little tenacity of purpose, I can take 3 cards and take somebody's money out there. Would you do me a favor and take out of the deck 2 black twos, or 2 twos that are black, whatever you find first. Now, the math students, they get the difference. Set them right here face up. 2 black twos?
Yep.
Pull out 1 red queen, uno quino. That's French. I'm bilateral. I speak Texan and English. No abo, tambien, escargot, y'all, something. Anyway, getting off track. How many have seen the shell game where they have 3 shells, a little pea, they move them around, you find the shell with the pea? Y'all know what I'm talking about, right?
Yeah.
If you walk the streets of New York, this is the sister to the shell game done with cards called 3 Card Monty. And if you're ever walking the streets of New York, you know where that pea is when you're putting your money down? It's not under any of the shells. They hide it in their hand. You say here, they go lift it up, they go nope, and they lift up the other shell, they redeposit, they said it's over here, they cheat. Damn cheaters. Well, this is the sister done with cards called 3 Card Monty. Again, what's that card, Poker Annie?
2 of clubs.
2. What's that?
2 of spades.
2 twos. Everybody, what's that card?
Queen.
Money, money, money. Everybody keep your eye glued to the queen. The queen is the money card, winning card, pay card. Let's say you can put $200 on the table. Anybody out there think they know where that queen is? Call it out if you think you know.
The test.
Hold it. The first lady they called out, what's your name?
Megan.
Who invited you? Right here, Megan?
Yeah.
What's that, Megan?
No.
What's this, Megan? Told you I was going to take 3 cards and take somebody's money. Megan, it's only 200, it's only cash, it's only, all face up? Okay, Megan, we'll give you a few warm-ups. And there were a few losers with you, so don't feel bad. You weren't the only one. Someone else thought it was the second one down. I heard them. I heard your bet go down. Watch again. They don't think I can hear every voice out there. I can. The idea of sin was called Find the Little Lady. Now, Jason is really good at this game. Jason,
yeah.
Tell Megan where the queen is. 1, 2, or 3?
3.
See how fast he got it, Megan? He good, isn't he? You know, 2 out of 3 times, he gets it when it's face up. True. We'll try it the other way. Pair of deuces. Keep your eye glued to that little lady. Keep your eye glued to the lady. Jason, tell Megan, 1, 2, 3.
Three?
You hesitated, but you got it. Let's put money back on the table. We'll go 100 a throw, Megan. Start working. You got the idea. Pair of deuces, pair of deuces, pair of deuces. Keep your eye on that little baby. Keep your eye on the baby. Megan, are you following? Yes or no?
Yeah.
1, 2, 3, Meg.
3.
Good job. Oh, Megan. We put money on the table. You start missing again. $300. Watch again. Pair of deuces. Pair of deuces, pair of deuces. Keep your eye on the baby, eye on the baby. Okay, poker, Annie. Are you following Annie?
Yep.
Tell him, 1, 2, 3.
1. 400.
I better slow it down for the losers. We have a winner. We have a loser, another loser. Slow motion. Now, are you all following or are you laughing? Remember, queen wins. Whatever you do, don't take one of those deuces. Trish, tell everybody.
The middle one, too.
Oh, you were so close. You were right next to it. Didn't count, but you were right next to it. She goes, what? When you watch, remember this. Remember this. When you pick the queen, when you pick the queen, you win the money. When you pick one of the deuces, that's when I win the money. Tell them, Annie. Oh, you need help too. Okay, how about this? How about this? How about this? How about this? What's that card, Annie?
Queen of Hearts.
What's in the corner?
A fold.
This is so, Megan, if you go to a place called New York, foreign country, they do this on the streets. And Megan, are you with me? I won't move or blink until you tell me when you're ready. Say go when you're ready.
Go.
Where is it, Megan? There you go. Oh, Megan. I hate to say it, but you're in debt. Here, I'll give you a souvenir, something to remind you, you should never play this. You want a queen or two? Which one, Annie?
I want a queen.
Take her. I don't know why she costs more than she... Show Megan, what'd you get? What'd you get? Another $100? Oh my gosh, you're down $1,100. Here, hand me that card face up. Everybody can see what you picked. Okay, Megan, this will be the... I'm going to give you one double or nothing. It's only because you guys are friends here, I'm going to give you a double or nothing. You don't usually give double or nothings. You had better luck with deuces. 1, 2, 3. Tell Trish she'll turn it over. Which one do you want to turn? 1, 2, or 3, out loud on a deuce. Go. Turn over the middle one. Tell us what it is out loud.
Ace of hearts.
Turn them all over. Turn them all over. What do you have? Turn them all over. What are they?
Ace of
Look under here, Megan. Look under here. Look under here. When the money gets big, Megan, I cheat. But I gave you fair warning, didn't I? All face up. In closing, in the game of life, stay focused on your game. Don't let anyone tell you you can't play or something's impossible. You know, take possible out of impossible. Take possible out of impossible. I understand that time to time we're all dealt a bad hand or two, but it's how we approach that hand. If we choose to fold wine, sit on our pity pot, or go all in, that's what separates losers from the winners. You know, respectful success comes from those who go for their dreams, achieve a state of excellence, analyze their obstacles and assets, stay loyal to virtues such as honesty and integrity, and have the tenacity to break down any barrier. DEALT. MIT students, big winners because of the way you play your hands. Here's one last thing for you, Megan. Are you paying attention? Here's something you never do when you play for money. Never do this. Never shuffle a deck, one in each hand. It makes the other players nervous. When they see you shuffle with one hand, if they see you shuffle with one hand while you triple cut with the other, they get up and run and you are left playing solitaire. And on that note, unless, of course, there's somebody out there that would like to stick around and maybe go out back and play a hand or two, that shows you what happens when you play with a cheat. Anyway, I hope you all had fun. Thank you very much. You're absolutely wonderful. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you, Trisha. Thank you, Annie. Did you have fun?
Yeah, I think I had a crush
at one point, but I traded in for the pair of sevens.
Thank you, buddy.
So that is absolutely a big wow. It's just absolutely amazing, Richard. Absolutely amazing. You're an amazing person.
Oh, I appreciate that, Al.
Now, we have actually quite a bit of time for Q&A. We have a couple of microphones on stands. I think something I would suggest so that Q&A doesn't get interrupted is that in some sense we say, okay, this is the end of the formal presentation, and if people have to leave, they have to leave, and that's fine, and you shouldn't feel embarrassed about it. And then for those that have questions and want to interact a bit more, let's open it up for questions. And now what I would suggest, we have the two microphones on the stands. If you come down to the microphone with your questions so that everybody can hear the questions. So, questions?
Yeah, there might not be any questions. What the heck? Yes.
Okay, so you said that you wanted to always to be in doing cards your whole life.
Right.
But was there any point in your life when you doubted that decision? And if so, what else would you have done?
Well, actually, I started off wanting to be an artist. When I was 5 years old, in finger painting class, I took a picture from a National Geographic and did it with a finger paint. I did a total seascape with a shark, jellyfish, angelfish, coral, and everything. And my kindergarten teacher said, look at what Ricky did. You know, all the other students were just smearing it across their face and just big messes, where I had this complete seascape. And they said, wow, he's got some talent. And so I started off as an artist. And then in first grade, I was the best. Second, third, and fourth grade is when all of a sudden, you know, my sister also got the same thing I got. And we both, within 30 seconds, lost our sight. We both got scarlet fever. And so, you know, so from going to be an artist, I realized I'm painting. In fact, I was telling you about the guys that jumped me. That was actually at a boys' club statewide art competition where I got first place, but I had to have my, I did a painting of three vases with proper shading and shadowing, light coming on one side on a thing, but I had to have my nose, just getting nose on my paint, to see what I was doing, and then slowly things just got worse and worse where I couldn't do what I wanted to do. But starting as a little kid, you know, 7 years old, about 2 years before that, our family, we were all card players. And because we were card players, you know, I never knew, we just played cards. And there was a TV show called Maverick, starring James Garner, Jack Kelly, and Roger Moore. He was the English guy. And I wanted to be a card shark, like James Garner. There's a part of the theme song that says, Natchez to Orleans, living on Jackson, Queens. I thought he was so cool, I wanted to be live on Jackson, Queens. So, because I was the oldest in the family, the oldest never lost, so I started designing and figuring out ways to make sure I didn't lose, and it kept perpetuating itself. My sister would say, my brother's so good, he never loses, and then more people would, so I started figuring out more and more ways, and then when I turned 21 is when I met Di Vernon, and the rest is history. But to answer your question, I never got discouraged with what I did, because it was an obsession. It was the other way around. I had to learn how to put cards down. You know, like if we're in a place, you know, like where they're, you know, quiet play orchestra at a play or something, or in church or whatever, and my wife would, you know, you'd hear this sound here. I'm sitting there doing one hand shuffles, you know, and you hear this sound here. And when there's nothing going on, everyone, is that guy flatulating over there? Or is that a rattlesnake? And but I never I don't want to use the word doubted, but I was just monofocused. My friend calls me a monomaniacal. I call him monomaniacal.
Great. Thank you very much.
I don't know if that answered your question or not.
Next question.
What would you say to any people in the room that haven't identified their passion yet?
What would I say to those who haven't identified their passion yet?
What advice would you have for identifying your passion?
Find out what you love, what excites you, what turns you on, what makes you not, where you don't have to be told to do it, you have to be told not to do it. My son, I was trying to figure out what was he going to do, Asa. And you know, in school, they don't at Trinity, they don't let them choose their major until you're a junior. And I kept going, what's he going to do? First, he wanted to be a neurologist, and he just kept going all over the place. And then he started getting into computer science, and it became a passion for him. Now he loves that, and it just kind of directed itself. Well, I was trying, I was trying to direct him a little bit. Growing up, he'll tell you this, I want him to see if he could follow after me, and then, of course, it turned out he was too smart to try to do what I did. But I would, you know, if he wanted to go see his friends, he had to do 100 false shuffles. If he wanted to an allowance, he had to learn a trick and do 100 false shuffles. And it became what, as he called, a punishment rather than a whatever. And so I realized, well, Dad, you're going to have to realize that that's not his passion. That's your passion. That's not his passion. But I say it's something that you don't have to be told about. It's something that you can't not do. At least that's the way I've seen it, and that's the way it was for me. And for other people that are like Tiger Woods and his golf club, and you know, you think about other people that they're just obsessed with something. They don't have to be told or pushed into practicing. It's like I said, they can't not do it.
Next question.
If you could restore your eyesight right now, like perfectly, no strings attached, would you do it?
No. I would, you know, there was a guy that actually had that happen. He was blind, and then they found a technology to where he could. And before that, he had the world's record for the fastest snow going down, skiing downhill, fast speed record, and a few other things. So he was extraordinary. And I've never met them, and I thought, well, he went, and then they restored his vision, and he went from extraordinary to ordinary. And I hate to, you know, I would be afraid that I would lose the touch. And because I have, you know, I don't actually see what is really out there, my son will tell you all his life, I see with my mind. Because I never use the word blind. I hate the word blind because, to me, I'm not blind, even though that's the most common word used for it. Because, you know, I see my subconscious externally. So I live in a very beautiful world. Right now I'm in what I call the blue spectrum. I have two red spectrums, red spectrum, blue spectrum. Blue spectrum is very, it's the artistic, right brain, left brain, very artistic, And where it's all random, it's like paint strokes of colors, and it's royal blue to turquoise blue to emerald green to lime green to yellows. And then in that, if you picture yourself underwater with every subconscious image just floating around anywhere, and like say I built a couple homes, or I want to design a deck, and my son will tell you this, he's watched me do it all his life. You know, I'll sit in a chair, and I will see it in three dimension, full scale, like I'm building a deck, okay? You have to engineer the whole thing, okay? You have to support beams. I need to be 4x12s there. I need a 4x12 cross, okay? Now I need 2x6s going, they're gonna have to be ends. And I would see the whole thing, and I dealt a three-level, 1,500 square foot deck, all without a single piece of paper. And my dad was my cutter. I said, Dad, this board has to be 192.25 inches. And it had built-in flower beds, picnic tables, a whole stairway, hanging swing, and everything was perfectly square. And they said most people that are in the carpentry and whatever, they don't end up square. But anyway, but that's how I see things. So I kind of like what I have. I do have to confess that when I went from being 2400 or 2450 or 2800, where I could still see shadows, you know, I could still see a person in front of me, you know, if I'm fighting. At least I knew where that the shadow was. As long as they were wearing white gi against a white background, they just disappeared. But as long as there was some kind of contrast, at least I knew where my target was. But now I can't see anything. So in that sense, it has made me have to depend a little bit more on people than I didn't like before. Put it that way. And over the years, I didn't like other people tell. When I do my shows at like the Magic Castle in Hollywood or other things, like here, it was part of the presentation. So I brought up the subject. But as my son will tell you, most of my performing, and I perform for more than most of the Fortune 500 companies. It'd be easier to name what I haven't than the ones I have. And but it's never brought up. It's never told. I do my stuff, and some people might figure it out. Some people might not. But like when I'm at the castle where it's a set down, organized show, 80% of the people walk out of there having no idea that the guy that just did the show was blind. In fact, I'll tell you a funny story. I was doing it, and it was the Miss America competition, and all the candidates came into the castle, and they were all wearing their tiaras or whatever they call those things on their head and so forth. And they were all sitting in my show, and this girl in the front goes, "Yeah, but can you do that if you were blindfolded?" And I said, "I don't know. Let's find out." I said, "Come here, stand behind me, poke your fingers in my eyes, and then cover them up, okay? Now, here we go. Shuffle the cards. How many players do you want? Where do you want to sit?" And then afterwards, she goes, "I guess he can." At another time, you may have heard the actress Stephanie Powers. Some of you, anyway, she was sitting right where Poker Annie's sitting at my table, and she starts, she goes, I say, you know, you heard me say, "Turn, make sure they're all face down, shuffle them up." So they do my dirty work for me, even though I can find a card when it's face up in the deck, it's just it's slower. It slows the show down, you know, if I'm sitting there, sitting there going and trying to cut to the card to turn it over, you know. And that, but that slows things down. So I'll let them do the dirty work. And then finally she turns to me and she goes, "Can you see? You can't see, can you?" And I say, "Shh, don't give away any secrets." And then she, she goes, "No, I'm serious, can you see?" And I'm going, "Shh, don't give away secrets." And then she goes, "No, I'm serious, can you? You can't see, can you?" And then I said, "Just watch." And then I'm going on with my show. And the whole time she's sitting there arguing with herself. She's going, you can't see. You can see, you can see, you can't see, you can see. And at the end, she finally concluded, "I don't know what I was thinking, you can see." And then she got up and her boyfriend told her, "He can't see," and she fell over.
That's great. Next question.
Hey, on one hand, I think it's super awesome that you named your son Ace of Spades.
But it's spelled A-S-A, Asa.
Asa
Spades. Yes. And it means physician or healer is what Asa means.
Oh. But do you ever I don't know, I feel like if I were your wife or your son at certain points, I would get, resentful.
Well, here's how it works. My wife, it's her fault. She was going through the Bible looking at names, Joshua, Jacob, David, Asa. She goes, "Asa, that's an interesting name. It means physician or healer." And it was King David's great-grandson. And then and she goes, "And his middle name could be Spades." And I jumped out of my chair. I said, "That's it. That's the perfect name." And she goes, no, I'm joking. We're not naming our son Ace of Spades. I said, "That's the perfect name." And once she stepped in it, she couldn't get out of it. And Ace will tell you, all his friends think he has the coolest name in the world. And you can Google him. The magicians out there will say, "Richard Turner's son has the coolest name. I would kill for that name." And then we were just looking up for something. I can't remember what we were looking up for. And then he saw how many people stole his name for email addresses and whatever. A-S-A-S-P-A-D-E-S. They actually stole his name because they've seen it because of me. But Asa, do you like your name?
Yeah.
I mean, he has his own identity just because of his name. And then I call him, like Spider-Man, I call him Spader-Man. So I was, Spader-Man, Spader-Man, does whatever a spader can.
Next question.
Hi, I was wondering if you could tell just a story or something of spending time at the castle with Vernon.
Oh, Vernon was a wonderful man. I told you how he would describe to me moves and techniques and you know, I'd sit and I would feel his hands and he would say, okay, now, Richard, what you do is you hold your hands like this. What you want to do is this. And I'll tell you, well, here's a story. Remember when I dealt out the pat hands and they kept shuffling and cutting she did everything she could to screw things up and I dealt that pat house, full house, remember what I'm talking about? Yeah. Now think about it, even though the deck was face up and you could see every card coming off the top, she grabs the tucks back, she shuffles them and then she gives me a little stack and then we could deal. How could that be conceivable? That's for the math people to figure out. Anyway, Professor said, I said, this would be the perfect thing. This would be the ultimate combination of techniques to be able to do this. It'd be so deceptive, and it would be so much cleaner, and it'd be perfect. And I was sitting at the castle, we were at the main bar. He was sitting on the end. I was standing up right next to him, and I asked Professor, what do you think about doing this and this and combining this? He's, Richard, it's not possible. You can't do it. It can't be done. I'll tell you what. Your brain can't move that fast. It can't respond that fast, and your hands can't be that sensitive. It can't be done. It's not possible. And I sat there going, oh, darn, it's not possible. And I was depressed for a full 10 minutes. I stood there just going, darn, I'm getting ready to do it in my show, too. And then all of a sudden it occurred to me, but I can do it. I said, Professor, come watch my show. And then after we come out of the close-up room, he goes, Richard, what the hell were you doing in there? I don't understand what the hell you were doing. I said, remember when you said you can't do this and this? Well, that's what I'm doing. So I don't understand how the hell you can do it. And then for the next 18 months, everybody, Jason, come here, watch this, shuffle the cards. How many players do you want, huh, Jason? Six, watch this. I'll deal them out, Richard, watch. Max, come here, watch this. Every person. And then finally, after 2 years, I don't know how the hell you can do it. he was my best man way back when, and he'd come over to my house, and I had my home is full of antiques from all over the world, and I also had cigars that were from right at the turn of the 19th century, and they were 2 for a nickel. And I had a cigar box full of them. They looked like dried dog turds pinched off. Literally, they looked like dried up dog turds. They were almost 100, but at that time, they were like 80-something years old. And he would come over to my house, and he's the only one I'd give one to. And he would sit in the back of his car on the way back to L.A. and smoke one of those wretched things. And he loved them, and the people in the car just cursed me and gagged because they were the stinkiest, wretchedest old things. He's sitting there smoking these almost century-old cigars and loving them. Any particular thing else you want me to share about? One thing about Vernon is he would never tip anything above your level. He only worked with you up to your level. In other words, magicians have what they call like a double lift, where they'll turn over two cards pretending it's one, and you show him some way, he'll show you a dozen ways of doing the same thing better. But then you say, Professor, will you show me your second deal? He won't do it. He would never show you up to past your level. And so to get him to tip what's known in the industry is what's called the real work, and the real work all relates to card gaming, to gaming, cheating at cards. Because the cards, the techniques for the table are just many, many times. Right, Joel? Joel?
Yes.
He's a top magician, a very fine magician, but he understands there is a distinction between the techniques to perform card magic and then to be able to deal a card from the middle of the deck, because what I'm doing are not tricks. They're just very difficult maneuvers with the cards. You have a comment on that, Joel?
Not at all.
Okay. But I don't know what my point was, but there it is.
So I think one more question,
yeah.
Right?
Richard, this is a little bit of a leading question. I'm hot on the heels of that beautiful three-card Monty demonstration, but could you share the story of the first time you visited the castle and how you addressed the dress code?
Oh, yeah, sure. When I went to meet Vernon, I was working on a TV series with a guy named Bob Yerkes, Y-E-R-K-E-S. You Google him, he's a man. He's done more stunts than anybody in history. Been a dear friend for 45 years, and he's 80. Last Saturday, he turned 85 years old. We were working on a show called Wonder Woman with Linda Carter and Circus of the Stars, where we trained circus. Like I took Jamie Lee, okay. You can't pass this on. But Jamie Lee Curtis, she was 18, I was 22. And I was there when she had her boob job. One day, she's just in the top part of a leotard. So one day she's here, and the next day she's here. And she and her mother went and did a little mother-daughter bonding and had little custom jobs together. And so I took her for her first swing on the trapeze, and a guy named, Richard Hatch, but he was not. There was three Richard Hatches out. The one that starred with Carl Malden in the Streets of San Francisco, that Richard Hatch, and the guy that played Jason in the horror movies. Anyway, I was working with on that series, and I just turned 21, and a friend said, "Di Vernon heard that you can do seconds and bottoms, and he's willing to meet with you." And he's the idol, he's the most famous card man in the world, the most famous close-up magician in the world. Doug Henning trained under him. A lot of people throughout the 20th century in the card and magic industry. He just, as he said, he just happened to outlive everybody. I'm getting off on a lot of tangents, sorry. Anyway, so I find out the night before I'm supposed to meet him at the Magic Castle in Hollywood. The Magic Castle is a 27,000 square foot Victorian mansion that is where it's only by invitation to get in, very formal, coat, tie. People, ladies actually will wear their wedding dresses there. And you can only get in by, like I said, invitation, and the biggest stars in the industry will go there. So I find out night before I need a tie, and I go, oh my gosh, I was poor back then. And I said, I don't have a tie, I can't afford a suit. And so I checked my gambling money, and I had a pile of 20s, So I went down to the Northridge Shopping Center, and I went into this men's store, and they had a coat rack. I set my cards on top of the coat rack. I started thumbing through coats, and this sales guy comes up to me and says, I'll cut you high card for that coat. I thought to myself, this is my lucky day. I said, okay, and he backs off. No, I'm just kidding. I said, tell you what. I just said, come over, follow me over. Went over to his checkout counter. I said, tell you what, I have three cards here, two jokers and a queen. If you tell me where the queen is, I'll pay double for that coat I picked out. You pocket the rest. And if you don't get it, you give me the coat for free. And he said, really? I said, really? Well, he went for it, so I did it. Darn if he didn't miss. I said, tell you what, I'll give you a chance to get your coat back. I'll bet the coat against a pair of matching pants. Lost again. I said, oh, I know, it's probably, you probably might get in trouble because you're either gonna have to pay for this yourself or I'll give you one more chance to get your coat and pants back. I'll bet the coat and pants gets a shirt and tie. Well, I walked out of there with a brand new suit and didn't pay a dime. I'll give you one more funny story that's kind of indirectly related. I wanted to carpet one of my homes in San Diego. And I went to the carpet place, and I walked in, and the guy says, hey, you're Richard Turner, I've seen you on That's Incredible. It was an old TV show back in the old days. And he goes, this is my place, I'll help you find your carpet. So as we're walking around, he said, that is so cool how you can hand people the exact number of cards. He said, between you and me, you have a special deck. They have little notches on them, a little indexing system. I said, I can do it with any deck. He said, no, you can't. I don't believe that for a second. I said, I can do it with a stack of postcards. I can do it with a stack of your personal business cards. So anyway, I picked out my carpet. We're in his office. And all of a sudden, he remembered what I said. He pulled his business cards off his desk and said, are you telling me you can do it with these? Well, I said, sure. He says, let me see you do it. I said, well, you don't work for free, so why should I? He says, I knew it. You can't do it. I said, tell you what, if I don't get the number you asked with your business cards, I'll pay double for the carpet. You know the rest. If I get it right, if I get it right, you carpet my house. Anyway, you guys were sure nice to me. I sure thank everybody. You guys have been so nice to me, and again, I appreciate it. And thank you, Al, for making this happen.
This show is
Did you have fun, Trish?
I had a blast. Thank you so much.
This was just incredibly entertaining and inspirational. And Richard, I can't thank you enough for making the trip here and sharing all these stories and your wizardry, and it's just absolutely astonishing. Thank you very much.
Oh, thank you, Al.
Richard, that was just absolutely.